in our latest Wanda webinar series. Our guest today is Samih Tukhan, chairman of Jabbar Group, a group that owns several e-commerce companies. And the topic we're going to be discussing today is, of course, e-commerce in the Arab world. Hi, Samih, and thanks for joining us.
Hi, Nadine. Thank you very much.
So let's start with the definition of e-commerce.
Okay. Before that, I want to have a small disclaimer. I'm not an expert in e-commerce. I'm a student of e-commerce. So 2 years old student. I'm an entrepreneur in e-commerce. So I'm learning as well. And e-commerce is new in the Arab world. Hopefully we'll all become experts. Definition of e-commerce, I mean, e-commerce can be usually it's a wide definition. It could mean the really the transaction and buying and selling of services on the internet or on any electronic network. That's the wide definition of e-commerce. So that could include, you know, any products and services. It could include selling books online or selling furniture online, or it could include services such as selling music or selling insurance or selling you know, e-learning and so on. So some people differ from people to another the way they define e-commerce. Some define it as retail goods, some define it as a broader definition of selling any goods and service online. There are different types of e-commerce. Of course, there are B2C, what we call business to consumer e-commerce. There is C2C, a consumer to consumer, where I can sell to another consumer and so on. And there is B2B, business to business e-commerce. To be honest, my experience and our focus as Jabbar Group is on consumer, online consumer business, which is B2C. So this is where I will be focusing on today.
Okay, can we talk at the beginning about your company, your e-commerce companies? You've got several, Cashew and Souq.com and others. If you could tell us about
that. Yes, after the sale of Maktoub to Yahoo 1.5 years ago, and that was one of the important deals in internet and technology in the region, we formed Jabbar Internet Group, which is an investment group in internet businesses, and we decided to focus on e-commerce because we believe you know, e-commerce is a growing market in the region. I'll be talking about that, and it's going to be one of the big businesses in the region. So we decided to focus on e-commerce. We raised some of the funds from around $30 million from the proceeds of the Yahoo deal and some additional funding from partners. And we invested in several companies. Our flagship company, which was also an older one from the time of Maktoub, is Souq.com, which is a marketplace. And we also have Cashew.com, which is an alternative payment method to credit cards. Something similar to PayPal, but customized and localized to the region. And then we have launched 6 months ago two products, Sukkar.com, which is a private online shopping club for apparel and accessories. And we have Kobon.com, which is a group buying similar to Groupon model in the region. And we have recently just launched Joob.com last month. It's still in beta testing. It's an online travel business, booking engine where you can book your tickets and hotels and so on online. And we have also two important companies, iQOO.com, which is the largest online advertising. That doesn't fall exactly in e-commerce, but it's the largest online advertising network in the region. And Tahaddi.com, which is the online games, massive multiplayer online games company in the region.
Wow, that's quite a bit. Okay, going back to Cashew. When you were developing Cashew, how did you convince local stores to partner with you and sell Cashew coupons?
Well, Cashew is also one of our products that was under the Maktoub umbrella at one point. And really the idea of Cashew was payment is an important part of e-commerce, and enabling payment is very important to the growth of e-commerce in the region. So Cashew came about, number one, the vision of Cashew was that there's lack of penetration. I mean, the penetration of credit cards in the region is low. A lot of the youth, if you like, in the region or people in the region are unbanked even. They don't have a bank account and so on in some countries. And also people who do have credit cards are scared or wary of using their credit card online for online purchases. This is changing, of course, as we speak. Penetration is increasing and people are becoming more confident to shop online and so on. However, alternative payment methods to credit cards exist, even in the US, which is high penetration credit card market. You have PayPal, which is one of the largest online payment methods. So this is where the idea of Cashu came, and we came up with the idea of customizing a wallet similar to PayPal to the region. So we used to print out coupons and what we call cards or coupons, where people buy these from retailers and scratch them and fill their wallets online. Of course, with time, in some countries, we are moving into more electronic methods. So from, like in Dubai now, in a month or two, you can fill from your online banking in your Cashu account and so on. So for to answer your question, for retailers, they share with us, they distribute our cards, and they share in the fees, in the Cashu fees. So they make money, and this is how we spread Cashu.
Okay. Let's talk about current trends in e-commerce, Samih. What's happening right now? What's changing?
Okay, this is a big question. Of course, worldwide is a bit different than in the Arab world. So I'll talk in general worldwide, and then we'll zoom in, if you like, to the Arab world. Worldwide, e-commerce is gaining momentum rapidly, if you like. I mean, I have one graph here. I don't know if it'll show on camera, but at least it's the US growth of e-commerce. Today, e-commerce in the US represents about 7 to 8% of retail commerce offline. So if you have, for example, several billion or trillion dollars of commerce conducted offline, 7 to 8% of that is being conducted online. That's in the US. In China, it's around 3%. So and you can see the growth. If you measure the growth growth over the last few years and projected numbers, you see a continuous growth in this. So what's happening is that you are seeing a shift from offline e-commerce to online e-commerce as technologies become more advanced, as people become more interested and more comfortable of shopping in shopping online, as services and products become more available online and so on. People, you will see a shift from offline towards online commerce. In the Arab world, I mean, unfortunately, there's no good research. Numbers and so on. So we try to come up with our own estimates and research and so on. There's still probably commerce still much less than 1% or 0.5% of total commerce. I mean, total retail commerce in the Arab world is probably estimated at $500 billion dollars. This is why we believe in a few years, let's say in 5 years, we can shift 5% of that online, then we're talking about a $25 billion market only in the Middle East region. So we think this market is big, it's going to grow. So the trend is going to increase towards a greater online commerce. In terms of types of what's the type of businesses that are going, e-commerce businesses going, we see, of course, in the US and more advanced market, we've seen general malls and e-commerce companies like Amazon and eBay and so on succeed. And now we are seeing more businesses go towards vertical e-commerce. So you will find companies that specialize in certain verticals, whether it's electronics or books or and so on. And so you're seeing more focus as you go, as time. For example, diapers.com is a famous company that was, I think, recently was acquired by Amazon. It specializes in baby, in diapers, really. So that shows you the focus as you go. As time passes, one of the trends today in e-commerce is social e-commerce. As social networks you know, advanced, and there's more and more people on Facebook and Twitter and on social networks and so on. We're seeing, we are going to see a trend towards e-commerce, social e, what we call social e-commerce. A good example of also social e-commerce is what we call group buying. So a lot of you probably heard of Groupon and Living Social, and now in the region we have Kobon. I actually probably forgot to mention Kobon as part of the Jabbar network. It's a 6 months old company and it's growing very fast. And we already have several players in the region, in Dubai and in, even in Jordan and different countries. We just launched Kobon in Saudi Arabia as the first group buying company. So the way group buying works is that you have a group of people, you have daily deals being sent to a group of people, and then if a certain number of people buy this certain product, a certain usually large discount applies to these people. So we're seeing a lot of hype around this, and Groupon is now one of the biggest, fastest growing companies in e-commerce in the world. One also trend I would like to talk about is also mobile e-commerce. I mean, this is probably non-existent in the Arab world. However, we are seeing now Amazon, eBay, they reported big increases on mobile e-commerce. And we see this according also as projected here, that in the future, in the next few years, mobile e-commerce will also gain around 2 to 3% of commerce in general. So that's a trend as smartphones become more advanced and people have more smartphones and so on. They will start using apps to shop using their mobiles, and we're seeing real results in that. Japan is a country that is very advanced in mobile e-commerce and is ahead of other countries. So that's definitely a trend. Probably still early in our region, as e-commerce online is still taking off, but I think it's a trend to watch going forward. One other area is virtual goods. This is especially evident in games. So you have, you know, these multiplayer big games. I'm sure a lot of people play games on Facebook and so on. So they buy virtual items and virtual goods. And this is a very big market and growing market. So as I said, many trends and so on. I would like actually to talk a bit about, can I, I took a bit of time on this, but it's important, but I want to talk about trends on why I believe e-commerce will grow in our region and in the world in general, but specifically in our region. The first point is that the Arab world is a youth market. We have a majority of the population is young population, and as these young people are all internet literate and are online, and as they they become working citizens and they start making more money, they are more likely in the future to buy online than the older generation and demographics. So we think this is a trend that will push e-commerce more and more online, commerce more and more online. And then number two, you have broadband and infrastructure is improving big time in the Arab world. We are seeing now ADSL lines and WiMAX, and we're seeing 3G on mobile and internet and so on in Jordan and in the UAE, in many countries in the Arab world, moving very fast. So broadband penetration is increasing. As broadband penetration increases, this will also push technologies and solutions of e-commerce online. Also, number three, I would say social networking. As I said, social networking is big. Today, with all these revolutions that happened in the Arab world, we saw in Egypt only in February, like 500,000 people in 1 month being added to Facebook. So you have a massive, massive increase in users on Facebook and Twitter and so on in the region. And as e-commerce, integrates with social network, and we're going to see more and more social shopping habits happening, this will also push e-commerce going forward. Number four, also, as I said, mobile commerce is important, and as mobile penetrations are high already in the region, but as penetrations of smartphones increase and shopping apps increase and so on, you will see more and more also development of growth in e-commerce. In general, as the online shopping experience becomes better in the region, we have more sites that are online, we have better customer service, we have services that are competing on a global level, even in our region, like we are doing now, we're trying to do with the Jabbar companies. You will find people trusting more and more e-commerce sites, and they will buy definitely buy online. So I think the trend towards e-commerce in the region is definitely an upward trend, and I see it becoming a really, really big market.
Okay, so let's talk about trust. You know, some people are reluctant, trust issues with payment methods, etc. How would you say you can get your company to get customers to trust in it as a seller?
Well, trust is a very important issue and very important point in e-commerce in general. As I said, in terms of payment, people are wary and scared to put their credit cards online and so on. But I think this is changing with time, and you have more and more trustworthy sellers coming online. Of course, if you are a small seller, then you have a bigger issue than well-known brands. For example, if you shop online on Amazon, so there is that element of trust there. As we shop with newer and newer brands online in the Middle East, the trust becomes more and more of an issue. But I think we have to look for sellers that provide good technologies, that provide certain certification, that provide good customer service, that provide good policies. You can read the policies on the side in terms of return, in terms of fraud protection, and so on. But I think also payment method. I mean, as if you want to set up your e-commerce business online, so it's important to offer. I mean, not all people will buy using credit cards. I mean, even in China, till today, 60 or 70 even percent of online buying happens through COD, which is cash on delivery. And we see this as the trend in our market. So if you buy a product, you don't have to necessarily pay using your credit card. You can pay using shop cash on delivery. And we have that option in all our services. We cooperate with Aramex and other delivery companies. So they come to your home and collect the money, and then you get the product. So I think that removes creates a big element of trust. Of course, some people want more convenience. They want to put their credit card online directly on the site. And I think if you trust the site, you have a good brand, and they provide good policies and good technology and so on, and they don't store your credit card. It only is processed and so on. So I think there is no issues. I mean, we know that fraud in credit cards, even offline, is bigger than online. So you get worried about even when you use your credit card in a restaurant and so on. In marketplaces in general, where you have consumer-to-consumer sites, for example, on Souq, if your consumer is selling consumer, we have something called a seller rating. So you have customers rating sellers. So you usually, if you buy from a seller that has a 100 positive rating, is better than buying from somebody who's selling you for the first time. So it's like the real world, you know. There are merchants and sellers you trust, and merchants and sellers you don't trust.
Okay. Well, speaking about trust, we just got an interesting question from our audience, and it is: will people's confidence in e-commerce be shattered by the recent PlayStation breach? When these things happen, how do you think it affects people's confidence?
Yes, I think, of course, they do affect. I mean, you have the PlayStation breach, and you have other breaches. But I think this applies to offline and to online as well. So you have credit card numbers. If you get Visa or MasterCard breached, and we get these hacks all the time, you could have your credit card. I mean, last month I got on my credit card offline, nothing to do with online, a credit card that I never use online. I got some purchases that I never used from Australia and other countries. So fraud on credit cards is a big issue, and it's a worldwide issue. It's offline and online. I don't think it's online only. But as I said, if you are not confident from buying, a good merchant site should provide you with different alternative payment methods. So they should provide you with credit cards. They should provide you with cash on delivery. They should provide you with Cashew. There's one card also similar to Cashew. There is different alternative methods that we're trying also to push. And this is also also where entrepreneurs, we need entrepreneurs. I mean, these are challenges in the Arab world when it comes to payment and logistics and trust and so on. So we need entrepreneurs to come up with ideas, to come up with innovative solutions to solve these problems. We should not be worried. Sometimes, you know, I meet young entrepreneurs who have good ideas. They want to start an e-commerce business and they're worried like, yeah, but, you know, people will not pay online and people are scared and people... I always look at these as challenges and problems that can be solved and should be solved by innovation and by ideas. So if you are an entrepreneur, you can come up with a good idea to solve the payment issue, to solve logistics, to make it easier for the consumer. It will make life better and it will only grow the market.
What about a lot of young entrepreneurs are asking about payment via mobile and SMS? For e-commerce as an alternative to cash
on yes well I as I said, the mobile e-commerce is going to be on the rise, but I see that as applications on mobile where you use an application to buy. You will still use your credit card number, or you can use Cashew, or you can ask for cash on delivery. I do not see SMS, especially in our region, as an enabler of e-commerce for several reasons. One, SMS is an older technology. The second reason is that, unfortunately, mobile operators in our countries are monopolies and have not really pushed. They usually share around 50% or 60% of the value of the SMS. So this is not feasible to conduct e-commerce using this. Hopefully this will change with time, but I do not see it as being a method used for buying goods and services online. However, some of the mobile operators have talked. I haven't seen any solutions yet. I've heard a lot of talk about mobile e-commerce and them creating wallets and them creating, for example, you can buy something and you can get your get it on your bill and you can pay the mobile operator. But until today, we haven't seen any really good solutions coming from the mobile operators. And unfortunately, they have not been helping innovation in that area. Okay. They will hate me for this, but I have to say the truth.
Let's talk about customers. Is it easier to aim for getting global customers in e-commerce than aiming for a local market?
No, I don't think so. I mean, at least from our experience in Jabbar, is that the Arab market is a big market. It's a 350 million market. It has its own challenges, but we have online today around 20% of that. 70 to 80 million people are already online, a youth population that is growing very fast, and these people will be online. So we see the Arab market as a huge market. Of course, there are challenges. There are not one country, there are 20 countries, and you have to deal with each region or each country on its own. But still, you have Egypt, you have North Africa, you have the Gulf State, you have the Levant. You can create good e-commerce companies and focus on the local market. I think it will be much more difficult to get global customers, but I'm not saying it's impossible. I mean, you can create solutions that can be global, and hopefully this will happen. But I think, as a focus, at least for us in Jabbar Internet Group, we are completely focused on the Arab world, and we think that's an good enough market. However, when we see opportunities to grow beyond the Arab world, we will. For example, in Cashew, we are now in Turkey, available in Turkey, and we will grow that market. We are looking at Africa, we're looking at other markets, but in other businesses we have, we are completely focused on the Arab world. And I advise entrepreneurs to start by focusing on a certain region. Maybe one country would be small enough, like if you focus on Jordan, it's only a 5-6 million country, or on Dubai, it's small. But if you focus on the Gulf region, or in Egypt, or on the whole Arab world, I think it's a good enough market. And then when you succeed there, maybe you can start thinking of going global.
So we talked about how payment methods, online payment methods, are, you know, a deterrent for many people. Another thing is customs and customs in the Arab world. So how can one deal with the challenges of customs when shipping items in this region, and what logistical solutions do you see people using?
Again, I see customs as a problem, a challenge, and an opportunity as well. Yes, it's an issue. We have different 22 countries. Maybe if you it's easier to take them region-wise. So if you take the GCC, the Gulf Cooperation Council, usually customs are easier because it's one region and so on. But if you want to ship an item from Dubai to Egypt or from Jordan to Morocco and so on, you will face customs issue. And this is a big problem in e-commerce in the Arab world. However, it's an opportunity because it's a barrier to entry to other competitors. And if you can solve that problem, for example, in our products, we might be launching, for example, sukkar today in GCC countries, but we will expand to Egypt. We will open a warehouse in Egypt. We will, so I see commerce being more local, like in Kobon. Now we are in Saudi. We will be in Egypt. We are in Jordan. We are in Beirut. We are in Dubai. We are in Abu Dhabi. So commerce will be more local with time. Souk, for example, we open in Egypt and Saudi. So you have to open in the country and you have to start thinking of supply chain and logistics and warehousing within each country, I think. You need to group them. I mean, you can't be in every country and it's going to require a lot of money and capital and so on. But I think you need to choose your markets at the beginning and then expand slowly. So I do not advise of selling, for example, products. I mean, it's still doable, but you will face issues if you're gonna be a merchant in Jordan and sell to Morocco. But if you establish local presence and you can solve these issues like customs and so on in a better way, I think.
Mm-hmm. Do you think the Arab world is learning from other e-commerce markets, especially markets like the US and China?
Well, I can speak about ourselves, yeah. Really, because we went to US, we went to Russia, we went to China and India, and we looked at several companies there. We looked about learnings from these countries. And I think these countries are ahead of us at least 3 to 5 years. Which means we can learn a lot. There's also a lot of similarities between, maybe there's more similarities, if you like, between the Arab world and China than the Arab world and US. There are differences, but in terms of, for example, penetration of credit cards, in terms of purchasing power, in terms of, and so on, it's better to look, I think, on China than to look at the US. So we looked in China, how they do delivery, how they do logistics, how they do payment, and so on. And we learned a lot. Yes, definitely, you can learn. So if you take the good things from the US, good things from China, good things from Russia, and then you start also implementing your own customization, localization to your markets, I think you will have a successful business.
So let's talk now in detail about e-commerce and the elements of starting an e-commerce business.
Yes.
This is where all the young entrepreneurs are waiting to hear from your experience, of course, on what, you know, the main steps and the main elements are.
Okay. I think the Arab world is starting, as I said, in terms of e-commerce. So there's so many opportunities for young entrepreneurs and for people who are interested in e-commerce to build e-commerce businesses. I don't think that coming up with the idea is a problem. Some people always ask, should I invent something new? Should I be innovative? Or can I copy a model from outside? My answer to that always is that you don't have to always be an inventor or an innovator and create something new. I mean, there are models there that you can use and copy. That there's nothing wrong with that, because if you can create a company, at the end of the day, the most important thing for me is creating jobs. If you can create a company that can create jobs, so what? Even if it's a model that is completely copied from outside. Why do you have to, like, for example, in offline, if you want to open a hotel, is it bad? No, there are hotels in the world. Copying a model and customizing it and localizing it to the region is completely okay, I think, and you should go ahead. And also innovating and coming up with new ideas that can solve e-commerce problems in our region is also something important. So I think both can live and both can grow, and both are important for an ecosystem in the region. Now, in terms of if you have an idea and you want to start your e-commerce business in the region, there's so many advice and tips I can give. But the first thing I would say is that you need to compare it to offline. You cannot just say, I want to start something online and sell online. This is, as I said at the beginning, e-commerce is a shift of from offline to online. So if you want to sell, for example, cups, or if you want to sell women's products, if you want to sell any specific product, I advise you to research the offline market and to see how sizable is that market. Is that market, how big is it in Egypt? How big is it in Saudi? How big is it in the Arab world? And then from that, try to project how much of that you can shift, or in general, how much would the market shift online, and how much of that you would you take yourself as a market share. That's the basis for building a business model and a business plan for an e-commerce product. So to just to go in more detail, but it's important. If selling cups, for example, is a $100 million market in the Arab world, then we could say that in 5 years, 5% of this market could go online, which means it's $5 million market. And if you can take as a business 10% of that, you are taking $500,000 out of that market share. So that's how you should calculate it and build a complete detailed business model of that based on the offline market that you are projecting and how much of it will go online. After you do that, I think you need to finance your company very well and get the right financing, because it's not just about putting a website online. Creating an e-commerce business requires branding, advertising, online advertising, offline advertising, requires good technology. Remember, we talked about trust and how important it is to create, to have the best technology and to create trust for your user. So the user, if the user doesn't trust you, they will not buy online from you. And they have, if they have a bad experience, they will never come back again. So you need the best technology, you need the you need to advertise, you need to create that trust element and brand element in your product. And also you need to decide whether you have how to solve the supply and chain, the warehousing, the complete supply chain cycle. So usually in marketplaces that are go-between, it's easier because you are a go-between between a buyer and seller. But if you are an e-tailer, it means you have to decide whether you want to build a warehouse or not, whether you want to stock some items or not. So it becomes a complex business, and you need to model that very well. You need to as we said, across countries, do you build a warehouse in Dubai, or do you build a warehouse in Dubai and in Jordan and in Egypt and in Saudi and so on. So all this should be built within a proper model and discussed with people who understand. I advise people to get mentors and talk to them about that model and create a proper model and seek financing. Financing today, I think after the Maktoub Yahoo deal, there are more interest in the region in terms of financing. We are seeing several local and regional VCs coming up. We are seeing interest from international venture capitalists and investors to put money in the region. So get the right financing and build your business strongly from the beginning. Payment, we talked about payment, is very important. My advice is to offer as many payment methods as possible. Make it, be flexible, make it easy to the customer. Don't just say, I'm going to offer credit cards, offer cash on delivery. Offer the best convenient service for your customers. Because at the end of the day, there are four elements to a successful e-commerce business. And these are, number one, price. People will buy online if the price is cheaper. I mean, they don't want to, if they can buy it next door or go to the mall, they will not, you know, why would they buy online? So if your price is competitive and cheaper, is even better, because this will enhance them to buy from you. Number two is convenient. If it's more convenient from them, they are sitting at home and your site is very usable and user friendly and they can buy from you, they will buy from you. They will not go offline. Number three is selection. People want, you know, they can go to a shop and see a few items, but if your site offers a huge catalog and they can find thousands and thousands of items, and this is very, very important. And number four, and I emphasize that, is customer service. So if they find good customer service, if they find the local number, you can answer their phone, you can answer their problems, you can help them go through the e-commerce experience. If they get better customer service, better delivery, faster delivery. For example, in China, we learned that now they are delivering next day delivery, and they are focusing on deliver same day delivery. So you that requires, of course, it's not easy. It requires, you know, a complete investment, huge investments in infrastructure and supply chain. But this is where e-commerce is. In the future, I see e-commerce. You order something and in 1 hour or 2 hours, you get it at your home. So that's where the trends are heading. Offer the best customer service, offer the best prices, offer the best selection, and I think you will have a successful e-commerce site.
Well, some of our viewers are thinking that obviously it's much easier to start up a digital e-commerce business than selling digital products, I mean, than having, you know, warehouses and all of that. Is it a big difference in as far as setting up the business, whether you're selling digital products or physical products?
Yeah, to be honest, I mean, my experience, I'm going to speak as in general, because our companies, we do not sell digital products. However, I don't think, I mean, obviously, in some areas, you might find it more easier. For example, physical goods would require delivery and warehousing and so on. But this might not be available in digital products. But digital products also have their own issues. For example, music, you have copyright. Digital products are easier to copy and so on. So I think you have challenges in digital or in physical goods products and services. So I think I don't think one is easier than the other, definitely.
Okay. Going back to one of your companies, Souq.com, what kind of e-commerce companies do you see doing well on Souq?
Okay, good question, because I have some presentation here about Souq. But Souq gives us a good data, because Souq has been there for several years in the region. And Souq.com is a unique company, because Souq.com is a marketplace. So we are not the seller. Although we will be selling, we are moving towards becoming a seller in certain categories and so on. But we are a marketplace. So we offer a platform for sellers and buyers to meet and buy from each other. And we are proud of Souq, because it also creates jobs, not only for employees of Souq, but for people at home. I mean, we have even women in Saudi Arabia and the UAE and so on that created businesses on Souq.com. And we have also businesses. For example, one of our competitors today, Nahal.com, started as a shop on Souq. You can, so that's also a tip for people who want to start to sell online. You don't have to necessarily go and create your own site immediately. You can build your own shop on Souq or on Amazon. And with time, if you think like Nahal did, you see success and you see sales and so on, and you build your knowledge, you can go and create your own e-commerce platform. So going back to Souq, I think we have interesting data from Souq. I'll share this with you. I mean, what customers are buying online on Souq, and this probably gives a good idea of where the interesting market is in the Arab world. So the first, I would say, the top category we have is apparel, clothing, shoes and accessories. That's number one category. Number two category is mobiles and accessories. And then number three is health and beauty, and then games, gadgets, computers and software, home furniture and garden, and so on. It goes on. So these are the top categories. They differ from country to the other. I mean, maybe in the US you will find music. You didn't find music here, but maybe the solution is not there. But in the US you have iTunes and you have solutions for music and so on. But this is what people are buying today in the Arab world, or at least on Souq.com. Of course, I didn't mention here, because Souq is a consumer retail product, I didn't mention here a very important market, which is the biggest in the region, is travel. Travel. People today buy online travel, airlines, hotels, and so on. This is the number one category for sure. And this is why we launched Joob.com last month, and now it's in beta version. You can check it, joob.com, and hopefully this will become the booking engine of the Arab world. It's like Expedia and so on. So travel is huge. And then when you go into consumer goods, you find the clothes, apparel, and so on top. And then you have mobiles and accessories and computer products, and then health and beauty and games and gadgets. But also, I mean, this is what exists today. I think this doesn't mean that you can't create, you know, anything really, and you can sell it online, like baby products or home and garden. You can really think of any solution and sell it online, really.
Okay. Interesting question here about renting online.
Renting?
Yes.
Okay.
What are your thoughts on that? Renting products, I guess this applies maybe more in the digital product area?
It could apply in the digital, it could apply in the physical. We haven't done any products renting. I haven't seen any solution in the Arab world, but I'll tell you that this could be an interesting trend. I know, for example, several sites in the US. I mean, you could be talking about, for example, renting apartments or renting homes, but you could also be one of the very successful companies now in the US is called Chegg. I think it's Chegg, Chegg.com, and it's renting textbooks. So students, instead of buying textbooks for universities and schools in the US, they rent them. And this is extremely successful. So yes, renting is an interesting trend that is happening in the US. I haven't seen anything in the Arab world, but if you have an idea and good, we're ready to invest.
Good to know. What about, are there ways to use e-commerce to build a social enterprise?
Can you explain what you mean exactly?
Well, this is one of the questions that we just got on the Twitter channel, and it just, she's asking, are there ways to use e-commerce to build a social enterprise? So that's the question as is. Whoever sent us this question, if you just care to elaborate on it, and we'll jump on to
Yeah, I mean, I'm not sure I understand the question, but I'll try to answer, and if they elaborate, we can. I mean, e-commerce companies, like any other companies, online or offline, have a social responsibility, and you can create... you can use e-commerce to help charities, of course, and charities or any social development project. For example, now we're talking in Dubai to Dubai Care, which is you know, the organization that helps and so on. And we're trying to integrate them into our products. So, for example, if you buy online, maybe a certain amount or an extra amount from the customer can be used to go to Dubai Care. That's just an example. But we have in the past also used e-commerce to for causes. I think Yahoo has probably done a big campaign when there was an earthquake in Haiti and for Japan and so on. So there are different examples of how you can use e-commerce for social causes and social development.
Okay. What countries use e-commerce more than others? I mean, obviously it's not the same across the MENA region. And what is the reason that it's doing better in some territories over others?
I think probably Dubai, in terms of percentages, is the number one market for several reasons. One, the penetration, online penetration in the UAE, Dubai and the UAE in general, is high. It's around 50 to 60%. So it's comparable to worldwide markets. You also have a large community of expats that have been exposed to online e-commerce in the past. You have also a larger penetration of credit cards and so on. So Dubai is a good place where you have more mature e-commerce. However, we are seeing it's not the biggest market. I mean, Saudi Arabia is a big market. We're seeing e-commerce now developing very big in Saudi Arabia. We're seeing also Egypt becoming an interesting market. Maybe Egypt is going to be one of the biggest markets. It's 80 million population. Probably the purchasing power is much lower than Dubai or Saudi Arabia, but we see it as a big market. As I said at the beginning, it's local. So we have products like Kobon in Amman and in Beirut. So these are smaller markets, but they will come. They will come later on. So I think e-commerce will grow in all of the region, but in the Gulf it will be higher because of purchasing power and internet penetration. And it will then be bigger in Egypt and so on, and North Africa, and Levant will be probably the smallest, but will follow.
Going back just to Saudi Arabia, another question we got, I'm not sure what they mean exactly, but women in Saudi plus e-commerce should grow. I guess maybe, what do they mean? More women should work in e-commerce?
Well, it's not only in Saudi. Actually, there was a study, I don't have the numbers, but worldwide, even in the US, women are the biggest users of internet sites and the biggest shoppers online. So I don't know if that comes to a surprise to you. So I expect that it will be the same in the Arab world. I think I don't have the numbers from our sukkar product, but I think the majority or a big percentage, probably majority, and it's not 70 or 80%, probably 60, 55, 60% are women. If you go specifically on Saudi, yes, I think that's an interesting market. Women there have online access and have maybe higher purchasing power than other women in the other countries in the Arab world. So that, I think that's an interesting market, definitely.
So Samih, you know, just sort of wrapping up, what advice do you give young entrepreneurs wanting to start a business? Unless there's something you want to just sort of go over before.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about the importance of, first of all, when you have an idea, to research the market and create a good business model to get the right financing and to decide whether you're a marketplace or whether you're an e-tailer, to put the right technology together, to put the right product together, to have to invest in customer service, to deliver quickly, to provide. These are all very important elements of successful e-commerce. But however, I have other important metrics. I talked about some, but I'll summarize. When you have an e-commerce business, when you have an e-commerce site online, key metrics to look for. Number one, traffic and unique visitors. So this is why you need a good budget for marketing. This is why you need to create traffic. So you cannot just put a site there. You need, at the end of the day, it's a site that you need to get thousands and millions of visitors to. So because a percentage of these will convert to e-commerce buyers. So not every visitor to your site will convert to become a buyer. And we call that the conversion ratio. So the first thing to do is when you advertise and when you market and so on, you bring in traffic and you bring in unique users. So you want to maximize that. However, this doesn't mean that you have buyers. Now you have to think about something called the conversion ratio. How do I convert these visitors into buyers? And this, of course, is a science on its own. It has a lot of elements that go. The usability of your site, the brand of your site, the trust elements of your site, the customer service we talked about, the price. If you have a lower price in the market, people will your conversion ratios will be higher. People will buy you better. The promotions you make, the daily deals you make, the contact you have with your customers. I mean, if you somebody buys from you, maybe you learn more. I mean, Amazon is an expert in this. If you buy a book, they tell you who all else bought, what other books they bought, and so on. So you need to data mine your databases to target your customers better. So you don't want to send your customers email and marketing into things they are not interested in. So the more, the better you do your marketing job, your technology, your usability of the site, your customer service, the better you have, the higher your conversion ratio will be. Which means people will buy more from you. We talked about also your selection. We talked about product selection. People want selection. They don't want to come online and find a few products. They want you. They want catalogs. They want to find everything online. So you need to offer them best price, best selection, best customer service, and then you'll get a better conversion rate, and hopefully you'll make good money.
Okay. Interesting question that just came in. Are any markets more secure than others, and why?
More secure in terms of
e-commerce, I guess, shopping online.
Well, that depends. No, I mean, it depends really if where you're hosting. I mean, if your technology is hosted in a country that does not have proper, it's really not the country. It's the ISP you're dealing with. So even in the US or even in Europe, you can be dealing with what we call not first tier or second tier ISPs. You could be hosting with on networks that do not have good security or good technology and so on. So it's not as much a country issue as much of an ISP and where your technology is and what technology you and networks you are using, what technology and measures you are taking to ensure security for your customers. I'm sure there are, even in the US, you have customer merchants that you do not trust and you don't want to put your credit cards there. And you have merchants in other countries in Europe or in the Middle East that are completely trustworthy and they provide enough comfort for the user to use them.
Okay. How do you conduct good market research?
Well, obviously you have to use a market research firm.
Well, if you don't have the means,
but yeah. use online. I mean, the beauty of online today, and I think Maktoub offered, I mean, when I was there, we offered Maktoub Research, which was an online research product. And there are other companies that offer that. So you could use online, you could use surveys online, you can use Facebook, you can create focus groups, you can, if you don't have the means to hire a very advanced, you know, market research company, then you need to do it yourself and try to use online tools and so on and surveys to at least get customer data. I'm not myself, you know, I like on research and market online, but I'm not the kind of guy that would spend months and years just spending time on. You have to move fast, so you have to I think you study your market and move fast. Don't do too much extensive research, you know, because even in innovative products, sometimes research does not give you the right answer. If it's a product or a market that does not exist, you're probably gonna, your research is going to tell you the market is not there. So if it's something you're going to sell and that is already there, for example, when I gave the example of cups or computers, you have an offline market that exists. So conducting online research makes sense. Offline and online markets make sense because you can get data. But sometimes if you're going to come up with a completely innovative new idea that did not exist before, then probably you don't spend too much research on it, much time, you know, and go for it and try, and you have to try, and even if you fail, it's that's always my advice to entrepreneurs. Don't worry from failure, and you go back up stronger and you try again and you make it.
Okay, one final question. We have a skeptical viewer here who's asking, do Arab people pay for games and virtual goods? Do you charge the Hadi users? Does anybody pay?
Yes, I like skeptical users because I always have an answer, and because I'm an optimist in nature. Yes, they do pay. One number I will give, I never gave it before. Today, on Jabbar companies only, we are conducting $100 million of transactions every year. This is not our revenue. This is for merchants. For example, Souq, they have their own merchants and so on. Cashew, they have their own merchants. I tell you, the biggest category in our Cashew product is online games. So people are paying for virtual goods and they are paying a lot of money and so on. So $100 million of transactions are being conducted only on Jabbar sites. So I think the market is much bigger than people think.
Well, fantastic talk. Our viewers actually really enjoyed that. Thank you so much, Samih, unless there's something you want to add.
Thank you very much. As I said, it's a new market. It's a starting market. I advise everybody who have a good idea in e-commerce to go for it and not to think about the obstacles. The obstacles are always challenges and opportunities, and they are barriers to of entry to others. So these obstacles, if you solve these problems, you can create big businesses.
Great. That was very informative.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you very much.